Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the final day of the ASUS ROG Summer 2015 Hearthstone Tournament. I'm Liquid Monk. Joined with me, as always, every day and every day, is Liquid Savitz. And joining us for this match is Radu. How are you guys doing today, Radu?
I'm good. I'm here to see some good quality games by my teammates.
Yeah. Of course, unfortunately, you didn't advance today to the final playoffs, but you know, you have two great teammates who are competing in the round of eight, Life Coach and Tice.
Yeah, I hope some of them win. I hope actually that they meet in the finals, of course, but that's really hard to do.
Yeah, certainly it's very possible since they're on opposite sides of the bracket. How are you doing today, Savitz?
I'm amazing. First day was good, second day was great, and today is going to be epic. So all of these matches, we're going to show every single match today, all of the round of eight games, all the semifinals and the finals. I'm really excited.
Yeah, meanwhile, why don't we take a look at the brackets right now? Who do we have playing today as their first match? We're going to have Life Coach versus Powder. Now, Life Coach, he's been doing pretty well. He's pretty much won all his broadcasted games on the stage so far, bringing his signature Handlock, Druid, Hunter, and Patron Warrior, of course. Pretty much not changing it up. We'll see if he changes it up today. Meanwhile, we have Powder going on in the first match as well. You kind of lost to Powder recently today. Yesterday, actually. How did that go?
Well, I think that I was favored by lineup-wise, but the fact that he could drop his freeze mage gave him like a huge edge, but still I was a little bit favored, like really slightly, and it all went down to the final game where he drew perfectly with Druid, same as Oskaka, so I couldn't do anything versus that Druid draws. Druid is like the class that you
need to draw something in the early game to do good. If you don't, you just lose the game. But like, it seems that in tournaments people tend to grow to get Wild Growth more and innervate more because they mulligan perfectly.
Yeah. Well, the other matches of course will be Hoi versus Barton Creek. And on the other side of the bracket, we have Tice versus Vortex. Tice, again, one of your teammates. And the final match will be Tom versus
Oskaka.
Oskaka, yeah. Great matches overall. I think it's great to see that we have 7 out of 8 invited players in the final eight, which kind of means that invited players, they kind of deserve to have that one qualified player in the form of Martin Creek. I think we're pretty much ready to go almost into our first match. Let's take a look at the... let's just go into the first match right away, actually.
Yeah, let's see what these guys have in store for the first match. Players, of course, have been able to switch their deck list. They had their first set of deck list for day one. They were able to change for the second group stage, and they have been able to change again for the final day. And it seems that Life Coach is going to bring out Paladin this time around. Yeah. He has been sticking to his four classes during the first and second day, but now he's switching it up a little.
Yeah, very interesting there, because I think everyone predicted Life Coach to bring the exact same classes every single time. He's known as a very predictable player, but he's actually switching up. Do you think that's because... Well, RDU, I know you know why that's the case. Why did Nilum decide that Life Coach's best strategy was to not bring Handlock?
Well, I think that if you're known as a predictable player, you should try to not be predictable, right? And at the same time, because everybody can change the decks, they'll full counter Life Coach, and he doesn't want to like lose in top 8 because his opponent could change the decks. Of course, going with a comfortable decks is better in a tournament where you cannot change the decks, but here Life Coach adapted perfectly, I think, and I think he got the edge over Powder in this. I definitely think he has the better decks.
I really like the decision from Life Coach to drop the Handlock, because Handlock is a deck that he's very well known for, and it's something that Powder would expect from him. And not only that, but it's also that maybe the easiest to target deck out of his usual lineup. The other decks are way harder to counter, but Powder is a player who could have tried to bring a lineup just to beat the Handlock.
Yeah, exactly. An example of that is your team, RDU. You brought a really anti-Handlock lineup against team Value Town in the Archon League. Unfortunately, it didn't work out too well, but it just showed that there are many ways to counter Handlock.
Yeah, double BGH is one way, but you still have to draw them.
That's true. Is this the first time we see Control Warrior in this tournament? I think it's mostly been Patrons and Warrior Pants.
Oh, definitely.
It's probably the first time I see Life Coach playing Leper Gnome.
Yeah. That's also a really good point. Before, in the previous matches, Life Coach was playing more of a mid-range Hunter, but now it seems like more hybrid-y, I guess.
No, it looks like... Yeah, it can be both. I will not spoil it for you, Monk.
Okay.
You'll see.
Well, there is a Houndmaster, so it's another mid-range element, but... He definitely seemed like he was only playing Wimp Spinner before in previous matches.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a hybrid, because that Houndmaster. Houndmaster doesn't fit in the Face Hunter list, but we see the Leper Gnome, so it's not like fully a mid-range deck either.
Face is the place, yes.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely.
I really like Powder's decision here to, instead of bringing Patron Warrior like everyone else is, to bring Control Warrior, because I feel like if your opponent doesn't ban Patron Warrior, they probably have a strategy to counter Patron Warrior, as it's considered like probably the best deck right now.
I think he brought it because he expected Handlock, and he probably has like double BJH in his Warrior, and now like Life Coach not running Handlock, he definitely has like a huge edge. Like this Hunter should beat the Control Warrior like most of the time, like more than 65-70%, I think.
Even though it's really cool to see the Control Warrior, I think one weakness with that deck is that a lot of players in this tournament have been playing Druid, and we see the Druid from Life Coach in this match as well. So that's a problematic matchup for the Control Warrior for sure.
Well, actually, Powder banned Druid from Life Coach.
Oh, he did?
Yeah, so.
Oh, I missed that.
I guess that's like part of his strategy. He kind of wanted to predict that Life Coach would be bringing the Handlock, the Druid, the Hunter, and the Patron Warrior. And if you ban out the Druid, I guess Control Warrior does have a lot of good matchups.
Yeah, makes sense.
There is a chance that Powder went for the 3-0 Handlock strategy. We saw that he has Warlock. What if it's Maligos Warlock with double BGH? Then he would be really sad if Life Coach wouldn't have the Handlock, right?
Exactly.
It's the same thing that I tried to do in a league that I was playing versus Life Coach. I was like, I will just go double BGH, and he didn't play any BGH targets. Like, Life Coach is predictable, but he's not stupid. He knows when to change. He knows when people expect him. He knows how to do exactly what is needed to win the games. That's one of the reasons why he has the biggest win rate.
Yeah.
Hey, you know, not only that, but it seems like Life Coach's decision to bring some kind of Paladin might work out here, because like I feel like all sorts of Paladin do really well against Control Warrior.
Yeah, he would be fine with a mid-range Paladin too in this situation. But I still don't have that much faith in the deck, and I don't think it's simply strong enough. So I would expect it to be Control. I would expect it to be the aggro version normally. But I mean, it's Life Coach that we're talking about here, and Life Coach doesn't really play that many aggro decks. So I'm just gonna be excited to see what it is.
I think that every version of Paladin is favored versus Control Warrior, even the aggro, Control, and mid-range, all three are super favored.
Yeah, there's so many expensive cards in the Control Warrior that the hand is going to be somewhat heavy, so the Divine Favor is guaranteed to get a lot of value.
And not only that, the mid-range Paladin versus Control Warrior, it's one of the most one-sided matchups in the game statistically, with around an 82% win rate for mid-range Paladin in recent matches.
It is. Personally, I think that the biggest reason for that is the way that the hero powers line up. The Control Warrior simply doesn't have enough ways to deal with the spawning 1-1s. And in a long game, which both of the decks aim for, the 1-1s are just going to take over at some point.
Life Coach has a really good curve. He had like 2, 3, 4, 5. That's really nice. Now he only needs Savannah.
Well, I think one problem here is, I think Life Coach really wishes that Leper Gnome were a Web Spinner here, because sometimes you have the Houndmaster, but it feels like without a Web Spinner, sometimes the Houndmaster gets really dead.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. What are you, Radu? I want to hear from you. Which version do you like more if you're running that type of Hunter? Do you run two Shredders and one Houndmaster, or two Houndmasters and one Shredder?
Two Shredders and one Houndmaster, because double Houndmaster is like really situational, and by having one is same as Quartermaster. You still have the threat. Your opponent still need to play around him. Only if he's one, you still need to play around him. And the Shredders are more quality, and it's a better card overall.
Yeah, I agree with you, but I've seen a lot of lists run, even with without the Web Spinners, it might sometimes be like double Houndmaster. I'm a bit confused by that.
That's probably wrong.
Situation. Yeah.
Oh, that's gonna be huge after the BGH was dropped.
Oh yeah, I think there's two, and he does have the Brawl, so he kind of has a way to deal with that. But the BGH was the best possible way to deal with it, and now it's no longer available.
Here you could consider kill commanding the BGH, playing Leper Gnome Hero Power, push 7 to the face, and then have Dr. Boom next turn after your opponent played 1 BGH. He can also think that because he played 1 BGH Powder, he might have the second one or an answer for the big threats. But if he destroys his armor, instantly Shield Slam disappears, unless he has like Shield Block Shield Slam. And he already used the Shield Block earlier, so he'll not play around the second Shield Block and the Shield Slam. So I guess just dealing damage to the face and kill commanding the BGH, playing Leper Gnome Hero Power is a really good play.
Yeah.
Houndmaster will be good at some point, right?
I really like that play. I think that with this hand, with the Dr. Boom in his hand, he can go for a board control type of strategy. So those kill commands are kind of dead right now if he's not going for the burst. In a different situation, it could maybe make sense to try hold on to those and use them for phase. But here, it looks like the Lotep has really good chances to survive to the next turn with that kill command. So that's going to add another 5 phage damage anyway.
We see Powder not having BGH, but he has the Brawl. But if you miss the Brawl versus Boom, you probably insta-lose the game.
Oh man, that would be bad.
Yeah, not only that, even if, for example, Lotep survives the Brawl, that probably might come on turn 7, it's still pretty bad because you can't just use the Brawl and then develop another minion or execute the final minion that survives the Brawl as well.
If Powder goes for the Shield Maiden, do you think it's better for Life Coach to just ignore it and go for face? I think it is.
Yeah, for sure.
You are a Hunter, after all.
Yeah.
Face is the place, and Life Coach is the aggressor here. Powder is likely to have to make that trade anyway with the Shield Maiden.
It's a really good spot for Life Coach, even versus Brawl.
It is. He still has the high mains left too, so he might
goes for face.
Yep.
The one saving grace for Powder though is he does have 2 shield blocks remaining, I believe, in his hand. So after he stabilizes, if he can stabilize, then he'll be in a decent position.
But how do you stabilize here? Even after the Brawl, like, it's possible Lotep wins, it's possible Dr. Boom wins. Mm-hmm. And even if only a Boom bot survives, it's still one of the Boom bots will go to face and with the Death Rattle, and there's going to be a 1-1 up and another kill command in Life Coach's hand.
The thing is that if Savannah comes after Boom, it's GG.
Oh, of course.
Or after you Brawl.
Absolutely.
You have no answer for that.
He could draw into a shield slam from one of the blocks, but still
a lot of damage.
Yeah, still the Hyena survive.
And like, Powder doesn't know if Life Coach has Savannah. Like, he knows he doesn't have Savannah in the first 2 cards, but he could easily top deck Savannah and still play Boom to get a better curve. So Powder doesn't know if half of the hand is Savannah or not. He knows that half is certainly not Savannah because he didn't play it on turn 6.
I think he has 2 options here. He can either Brawl or try to shield block into like a shield slam. But that seems a bit risky. Like, it's so unlikely. Even with 2 shield blocks, he would have to get the shield slam. Okay, this is a big one.
Isn't it better to just trade first? Or do you hope you get lucky?
I think you have to hope to get lucky here.
Yeah, I think so too.
That's pretty good.
Only 1 damage. That was the, not the best result for Powder. Obviously, his Shield Maiden winning would have been the best possible thing, but that's still very good.
Yeah.
Even that Boom bot dealing only 1 damage is actually a big deal.
The bow is really good right now, but seeing Shield Blocks in Powder's hand is not exactly the best thing you would want.
Yeah, against the Shield Blocks, he would, like, best way for Life Coach would here be to play as many minions as strong as possible. But the minions he has, they're not that strong. Houndmaster is situational, and the Battle Cry would get wasted right now.
He could still play like Houndmaster, Leprenom, Eagle Home Bow. It's good if you top deck Quick Shot.
Yeah, he could do that.
Because if you don't play Houndmaster now, if you go for Hero Power, you get some extra damage. But is that damage really that important? Like, 4 damage is not. Probably Houndmaster is not going to die, and he's going to deal 4 damage, most likely, right?
Yeah.
He didn't have an answer for your ward earlier. So yeah, I definitely think that.
I like this. Because with even with the Shield Slam, like, he didn't have the Shield Slam, or he would have seen it last turn. It's kind of obvious. He figures that there's no removal. And even if he top decks the Shield Slam, it would only deal 2 damage with the Shield Block.
I actually like the Shield
Block.
Well, that's a good card for Powder right there.
He will take a lot of damage, though.
That
he can still play double Shield Block.
With double Shield Blocks in his hand, I think he's going to be fine.
Wow, double. Revenge is a really weird card. It's only good in these kind of situations.
Yeah, it's also only good if, it's much better if your opponent doesn't know about it. So Life Coach, being the first player to play against Powder in the bracket stage, it's gonna hurt him quite
a bit. Only 2 damage from the Boom, but again, this is suddenly looking really good for Powder. Life Coach only has the bow and the kill command in his hand.
He needs Savannah soon. Like, next turn.
Yeah.
I think you're fine just shield blocking here.
Oh, that's gonna be good as well.
Yeah. Well, that's a decent draw. Could have been worse.
It's good on curve.
It's not exactly a high main, but that's like the second best thing, I suppose, in this situation. Unless he runs something like Rag.
The bow is gonna get Harrisoned, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So, Life Coach's decision to not use the bow last turn is slightly hurting him, but I think it was a fine decision based on the fact that he probably wasn't gonna kill his opponent the next 2 turns.
Yeah, it was a good call, I think. It was the best play he could have made there. Powder just top decking the revenge.
What do you think is better for Powder now? Playing the Sludge Belcher to deny the Shredder? On the other hand, he knows that Life Coach might have the Iron Big Owl. That'll be really bad if he plays the Belcher.
There's only 1 card.
Iron Big Owl is lethal now.
Yeah. Let's see if he can draw it. Not quite.
Playing the explosive trap is really bad against Harrison, but... Yeah.
This worked out really well for Powder here, going for the Belcher instead of that, that Harrison Jones. Even though it was risky, the risk is paying off here.
Yeah, Powder played the defensive game and then just brawled and then double shield block to stabilize. That's like the standard control warrior dream.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And now it would be like Alexa's into Gromash finish. The continuation.
So Powder is just showing a clinic on how to play control warrior is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think Powder has played this really well.
Yeah, he played it really well. He knew when to go for the risky brawl and he knew when to stabilize.
Yeah, it seems that something really weird needs to happen in order for Powder to lose at this point. This next turn he can just drop the Chrome from his hand and use it for attacking.
Fortunately, that's gonna hurt a lot.
Powder might think it's also a freezing trap. But it doesn't really matter. You attack with Armorsmith.
Yeah, that belongs in the museum, right?
Strike. Would you ever play Gromash here? Just to push in Force Lethal next turn?
I think you Harrison here. That's too good to pass up. It's 2 charges on the weapon. You can even armor up and shield slam afterwards. You can
Is Harrison better than winning next turn? But actually, you don't know if it's explosive. Yeah, you expect the other secret. The ordering is good too. So now you just Harrison, see what you draw, and probably not even deal with the Frith too. It's not really that important.
Good, I'm gonna blame him for killing it off.
Yeah, you can, why not?
Just in case there's something like an owl into a quick shot or...
You get the armor, so...
Yeah. Might as well.
It's just the strength of the Sludge Vulture, or rather the Armorsmith behind a Sludge Vulture is so amazing.
Yeah, and going face there with the Belcher wouldn't still have set up lethal for the following turn. He needs 2 turns to kill Life Coach.
Would Life Coach win with the top deck quick shot into something next turn? Probably not.
No, I think
the slime plus the Armorsmith is just way too annoying.
Yeah.
Quick shot into owl.
Would that do it? 3 dogs and kill command. No.
There's also the chance that Powder gets the Alexstrasza and then he goes outside reach.
Sure. Actually, in theory, he could have it. If Powder only armors up, he's gonna be at 12. So unleash for 3 dogs, kill command phase, owl quick shot. That would be... No, it would still be 1 off, right? It's 3 from the dogs, 3 from the quick shot, and 5 from the kill command, so that's 11. So even that would not do it.
The only thing that Life Coach should hope for really is if Powder really overcommits the board.
Oh yeah, and then he gets sell.
It's hard as a control warrior.
Yeah, there's not that many small minions. I mean, Dr. Boom, I guess that would that would be a lot of minions.
If you want to threaten something, you probably just play Gromash, hero power.
I think so, yeah.
If even that, because you're afraid. Like, unless you have lethal next turn, you shouldn't play anything.
Does the Chrome set up lethal?
No.
It actually doesn't. He would be 1 off because he has 7 on board right now. He can push Life Coach down to 12 with the Chrome.
And the thing is that if he top decks Revenge or Whirlwind or Kroll'tas Master, he can play it next turn anyways.
That's true.
Now all Powder has to think of is what 3-card combination could kill him right now. And there are definitely combinations that
Quick
could kill
Shot
him.
Into Owl.
Oh! Oh
my god! Because of the extra minion that Powder just played, now he would get 4 dogs from the Unleash. So if he gets the Owl from the Quick Shot, that'll be exactly lethal.
Will it?
Yes.
Wow.
But it has to be that. How many owls does he play?
I cannot say. That was a good bait.
Oh my god.
Let's see it.
How many cards are remaining in Life Coach's deck? We cannot see.
There's not that many, and he hasn't played any owls yet. Does he get it?
Oh.
Not quite.
That was close.
Yeah.
He still didn't lose. Like, we know Powder doesn't have anything. And if Powder doesn't get Alistaza or a trigger for Gromash or a weapon, Life Coach might still top deck something next turn.
So the real question here is, what do you do with these hounds? Like, do you actually kill off this Armorsmith?
I think you kill off the slime and just go face with 2 of them. I don't know.
It's you just kill the slime, go for face and push damage.
Yeah.
Like, you'll still put your opponent at 2 HP. So many top decks.
Yeah.
Killing Smith is not worth
it. No, the Smith is gonna have a hint of his thing.
I don't really like killing Smith.
Yeah.
because now it's really hard to get six. But if you put him at two, he will get some armor. Of course, he can put himself to six. I don't know, it's probably the same thing, but he would have done the trade with Harrison and Grommash. That Belcher is huge.
Yeah, it is. Kind of locks up. I don't think there's anything now.
Quick shot into...
No.
That was a really close game.
Oh sure, yeah, definitely. And you know what? It all came down to that brawl, which Powder sort of won. The Boom Bop came out, which is kind of the middle choice. I think if Shield Maiden came out, Powder would be in favor. But if Dr. Boom or Lotheb came out, it would pretty much be an instant loss. So
yeah.
Brawl pretty much gave Powder a 3/5 chance to win, and it gave Life Coach a 2/5 chance to win.
Yeah, but Powder was not in a good spot. He knew exactly when to use the Brawl, and he knew how to manage the risk. Yeah. So that's what makes him a good player.
He got a bit lucky there, too. Those Boom Bots hitting phase only for the first Boom Bot only dealt one damage. Imagine if it dealt four. It would be a different game if it dealt four. And the second Boom, but also hit face, it only dealt two damage.
Exactly.
So below average on both of those.
I think, how much was Life Coach off of lethal at one point? Like two damage, pretty
two
much?
Two damage in the last turn.
Yeah. So if the Boom Bot was something.
So an average Boom Bot hit would win. But this is like Hearthstone.
Yeah.
Like, overall, the player that knows how to use the RNG most consistently is going to be favored anyways. So the series is not over by far.
I think this... it's a little error on the graphics. It's Powder who actually won the last game with Control Warrior.
Yeah,
and Life Coach is Hunter is still available.
These would be the graphics for last hero standing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, Druid and Warlock remaining for Powder. You theorize that maybe Powder is running Maligos Warlock?
Yeah, Maligos Warlock with double BGH, Control Warrior with double BGH, Druid with double BGH to full counter Life Coach mm-hmm. and guarantee the win versus Handlock. And well, bam, Life Coach has no Handlock.
Well, here's
good
the
luck,
thing.
Powder.
Here's the thing. If you go all in into countering Life Coach, this is still like an 8-man bracket, and you still have to use the same decks afterwards. How all in do you go?
Okay, if you put Life Coach on having Handlock like 90%, and you can give yourself like an 80% win rate on the series, 80% having 80% in top 8 and then having like 40% in top 4 and 40% in the finals is still worth it. You guarantee yourself a lot more BlizzCon points, a lot more money, a lot more exposure for top 4. And at the same time, you still have a 40% chance to win versus the other guy. It's still Hearthstone. You can win with double BG. You just play the reversed Harvest Golem as a 4-2.
Yeah. And Handlock is also really popular, so there are other players who could potentially bring it. It's even likely. I think it's more likely than not that some others will also be playing it.
Yeah, so you guarantee that you face somebody with Handlock and then somebody else, but the guarantee is not that.
Yeah, but sometimes I feel like you overthink things. I know, like, you, Radu, you always try to counter people in the round of eight. The best example I can give is probably you versus Orange in the ESL Katowice tournament, where I think the interview game later was basically like you overthought it and you brought like difficult or different decks.
Not really. I think that it all went down to like super RNG there. Mm-hmm. I just think I had the better lineup.
Okay, fair enough.
Like, it's worth it to go for counter top 8 lineup, because if you can guarantee like super good odds, even if you have like lower odds in the next round, it's still okay. And there I actually counter like more players than Orange. I counter the first four players. But sometimes it doesn't matter.
This is pretty amazing. I'm still not completely buying it. Is it going to be Maligos? But Powder, it could definitely be. But it might be something else.
Yeah, Maligos Warlock is kind of a deck that's not too popular these days after DreamHack, where it kind of dominated.
Even though we've been theorizing a lot over it, there's actually no real like evidence right now that Powder's strategy would be so heavy on countering the Handlock.
Powder is a really smart player that knows how to take decisions.
Oh, well,
there's your evidence.
Yep, there's my evidence. That's Soulfire and the Twilight Drake.
Yeah. Ardy is like, just giggling right now.
Yeah, because Powder went all in on countering Handlock. He does the exact same mistake I made in the league versus Life Coach. I was like, yeah, he's my teammate. I know he's going to play Handlock for sure. And yeah.
No, I mean, still Maligos Warlock isn't like a terrible deck by any means, right?
It's like subpar. I think it got like a really lucky win streak at DreamHack. I'd never considered the deck really good. The deck is just not that good if you don't draw Emperor. And if you draw Emperor every game, why not play Druid or Patron?
Yeah, if you get that lucky, right?
Yeah, but like I don't know. I think that this type of Warlock is like worse than the Zoo, is less consistent, and it's worse than the Handlock, is less powerful. Mm. Like on turn four, the best threat you can have is like a Twilight Drake. Even if you play like Handlock with like demons, still the Voidcaller is like better than the Twilight Drake. And also Imgang Boss is a really subpar card most of the time versus what is played right now.
Well, here it's looking pretty amazing. There's no good way to deal with the Imgang Boss right now.
Yeah. Another thing to consider about this matchup is I feel like
this matchup, the Hunter versus Malygos Warlock, is really favored towards Hunter, because as the Malygos Warlock, I sometimes feel that you're just kind of playing Handlock without Molten Giant, which are one of your best tools against Hunter.
Here, I think it's correct to trade into the 1-1.
I think so. Otherwise, it gets an easy trade with the
and just Hero Power. Lepronome. And then he will trade for you, and you play Shredder, and yep. You gain the board. Ling Yang boss is really good versus Hunter.
I don't think it's worth it to go face here instead of the.
Consider's quick shot.
I mean,
I'm not a big fan of quick shot.
The only thing with attacking the 1-1 is that there might be some mortal coil. Okay, here if you kill off the Imp Gang boss, then it makes sense that to also go face.
Powder can now dart bomb, but his curve would be pretty bad if he dart bombs. He has Twilight Ray next turn. Right.
It's gonna be
like
big
6
enough.
HP.
Like, yeah, I think the 6 HP is like the sweet spot. 6 is what you want to have at minimum. If it was 5, it would just die to a kill command.
Shredder is really powerful, but being targeted by Twilight Ray, Powder will have the board. He can also like consider implosioning, but maybe not, because if you hit for 2, you're in a really bad spot. That's another reason why
he can't trade them still, so it's not that awful. I'm not saying it's great, but he could try to go for it.
Powder Sand is really subpar. You don't want to have the Soulfire, and Implosion is not that good in this matchup because you can get Unleashed.
Yeah, that's true.
But the thing is that he already saw a Juggler, so he doesn't expect Unleash. That's some good quality esports. Oh, Savannah. Hyena, I mean.
Yeah.
So if Unleash the Hound came here, that would be pretty awesome.
Oh,
that would be fun.
That would be a 6-4 or Hyena.
I remember back in the day, Life Coach's most favorite card was the Scavenging Hyena, right?
That's why he got it.
Yeah. Imagine if he rolled a 4 there and Life Coach had an Unleash.
Life Coach would actually not want that because he might expect double BGH from Powder.
Oh, right.
That's a good point.
I think that by now Life Coach knows what Powder strategy is.
Yeah.
When you see your opponent running Control Warrior Malygos, you know what he tried to counter from your lineup.
Yep. So what are the options here? Playing the Scientist Creeper or Shredder? Which one do you like more?
Shredder, because it's better on the curve.
Because it's better.
Like, yeah. You can play double 2-drops in Hero Power, and the Scientist and Creeper don't offer you the same things that Shredder does.
Yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah. The other thing to consider is, even though you expect your opponent to kind of play the Sludge Belcher on their next turn, and it deals well with the Pilot Trainer, you also have the Kill Command to deal with that as well.
Hmm. I don't think this is necessarily worse, because it's kind of the same amount of stats on the board. And getting the Secret out early can be really beneficial.
I guess it's fine. You want to get a Secret out before you draw it. That's like one of the ways you lose as a Hunter.
Yeah,
especially
exactly.
Mid-range. So Powder goes for the late Drake.
This is not looking too bad for Powder right now.
Yeah, he's stabilizing quite well.
Is Life Coach going to play around Hellfire, or is he just going to do it?
Just do it. I think he might just do it.
He might trade Scientist to get a trap, but if he gets Explode, he's in a bad spot.
Yeah.
So I think you just play it and go for face. You'll probably play the second Scientist too.
Also,
or maybe Hero Power might be better.
This Malygos list typically only runs one Hellfire anyway, so it's one less card compared to most Handlocks that you have to think about and play around.
Right.
Life Coach needs bigger threats. Savannah and Boom is what he wants now. Probably not Boom, because if he gets Boom versus BGH, it's not exactly the best thing ever.
There's a few options here, but the Kill Command is no good. I don't really expect him to do that. But he can Shredder Scientist. Or he can trade our Hero Power, he can trade in the Scientist, or he can go face with it. But I kind of like the face because of the lack of Molten Giants in the deck. I'm sure Life Coach has it figured out at this point that there are no Molten Giants coming, so no need to worry about the Warlock's Life Total.
Actually, one thing to consider is Life Coach, he's still not completely sure if this is Malygos Warlock or if it's some kind of like control demon lock. There have been variations of Demon Lock that include like pretty much all the cards that have been used.
Yeah, and they just
replace Azure Drake and the all the dragons with Void Callers, Mel'Ganis, and Drakus, for example.
I'm not sure if the running Implosion in that version is too many 4-drops.
I think it, one of the original versions that got number one ranked legend on Europe and North America, it did run Implosion.
But he already sold two Implosions. I think that when you see Implosion and Drake, you are like, okay, it's Maligos.
Yeah. And the Imp Gang Boss also.
Yeah, Imp Gang Boss too. It's too many early game cards, and they have to justify a late game powerful card like Maligos. Again, he's really scared of Unleash. Right now.
Yep, he should be.
Loteb is a really good draw.
Just
play Loteb and go for face, probably.
Yeah.
I don't think even Scientist getting the hero power in is more important.
Probably. I mean, the Scientist is likely to get 2 damage on the following turn. Because with the Loteb effect up, there won't be any AoE coming. So I think that a case could be made in favor of the Scientist too. Because the hero power is 2 damage, but the Scientist is going to get that extra attack for sure.
I completely agree. And not only that, but we probably know that Life Coach is running 2 types of secrets. So it's not like if both Scientists die at the same time, then... like something
that
the
secret
happened.
Would get wasted.
Exactly.
Yeah. Also, I guess that kind of enables the quickshot to be used more easily next turn.
Also, if both scientists die, then you have less of a chance of drawing a secret, which means you top deck better in later turns as well.
Yeah. But so again, like with the Loteb every pop, it seems really unlikely that they would die.
Just basically the Loteb changed the deal. Last turn, Life Coach decides to hero power instead of Mad Scientist. But because of that Loteb, like Savitsu, like you said, he goes for the Scientist on this turn instead.
Yep.
There's the first BGH.
Okay, so the Loteb is probably going to be traded for.
You guys can't see this, but RDU has such a huge smile when he says, oh, that.
Yeah, because I predicted Powder's strategy like after I saw his first deck. I didn't expect him to go that much all-in. Like, it's really risky to go so much all-in into the top 8. Like, why not just play our comfortable decks? His lineup was really good yesterday. Why would you change everything just to bank it on Life Coach playing Handlock? Like, do you put him, like, 100% to play a deck?
He could play a Healbot and an Owl and trade for that Creeper if he's not worried about the secrets that much. This would only leave the 2 Scientists up and he would heal back to 22.
The way Powder wins this game is by stabilizing with double healbot.
Yeah.
There is also like a way you win if you play Maligos and he survives one turn and then you just burst him down.
Mm-hmm.
But then Maligos is really bad to Hunter's Mark if Life Coach runs that.
That's true.
I think you saw Hunter's Mark in one of the Milligans, right?
Yeah, I think he had it. But the thing is that Life Coach is really low on cards right now, so it seems unlikely that he would have Hunter's Mark. Oh, that's a bad throw. Definitely not something that Life Coach wanted here. What he wanted was basically anything else but a secret. Yeah. But at least it's a better secret in this situation.
He could play all his hand.
And also at least that basically that owl was kind of useless in silencing that mad scientist.
Oh, that's true. So if that...
The owl was good because of the curve. It fit the curve. Yeah.
Like one of the scientists was not working out anyway, so that owl... because of that throw, it wasn't that meaningful.
Now Life Coach is thinking, what is the chance that if I play this secret, Powder is going to think it's Snake Trap and not attack into my minions? Because if Powder thinks it's Snake Trap and he attacks in something else, he probably loses the game. But if he attacks correctly, he's in a really good spot because he can trade and then proc it with the 1-1.
Well, the issue there is Powder saw the Explosive Trap last game, and it's very, very rare for someone to run both Explosive and Snake in the same deck.
Yeah, I mean, it's possible though, but, yeah.
It makes it look like freezing.
I don't think he's bluffing.
No, that doesn't
here.
Look like freezing at all. Well, who would play freezing into a healbot? Has to be either snakes or.
It's really slow, actually.
I like this play.
Yeah, this play a lot. You bounce your healbot back. So even though you didn't draw 2 healbots, it's essentially like you have 2 healbots in your deck.
Yeah. Buys him more time.
That's why one of the reasons why Life Coach should have traded with the 2-2 probably, that the other one. So he plays around Mortal Coil.
Test freezing trap. Well played by Powder there.
Do you think, what about attacking the face there instead of attacking a minion? You trigger the explosive trap and you don't trigger a snake trap, which you can't deal with anyway.
Yeah, I actually would have liked it a tiny bit more. You're getting rid of the explosive trap at the same time and you don't risk the...
Actually, I think it's a really smart play by Powder. If he doesn't play the City Swampus, it was a really smart play because leaving Life Coach 1 secret up, he will want to play the weapon as up, and then Powder just the City Swampus uses the weapon.
That works.
Yeah, but you still feel like if he had, if Life Coach had a weapon, then he would play it anyway, regardless of the ooze, right?
Yeah. I mean,
it's not like it's a Harrison Jones.
I feel like that was a big mistake from a Life Coach there, leaving the heal pot up. Is it just me? But that seems like it was a. It was so unlikely that it would get bounced back. And that extra heal, how can he deal so much damage?
Hero power?
Like he had easy trades for there.
He could have just hit with the 2-2 scientist that is silenced. And then he wouldn't go for the mortal coil. He would force powder to a dart bomb.
Yeah, that heal about is 8 extra healing. That's a huge deal.
Yeah, powder controls the game right now. He just needs to stabilize, as I said. And that's the second healbot that I told you about. And now if he gets the third healbot.
Third healbot incoming.
He took one extra damage for dart bombing now and not dart bombing last turn. Mm-hmm. But it was a hard decision.
Yeah.
Hotmaster is not that bad.
It's okay. He can immediately pop one of those.
Blackwitch is going for the full face play.
Yeah, he has to at this point. There's no way he's winning a board control game. There's absolutely no way. With Powder having, what is that, 8 cards in his hand? 7 cards. There's no chance that Blackwitch would win if he was to try to battle for the board.
Yeah, now we see the problem of having 2 Azure Drakes in this deck. They don't seem to be that good, and I almost feel like they're mostly there for the Dragon ability to combo with the Blackwing Corruptors. And we've seen some Malygos lists that actually even cut these Azure Drakes in favor of Molten's, making it kind of more like a handbox.
Azure Drakes are there to be more extra dragons for the Blackwing Corruptors.
Yeah, there's also a lot of spells. I think you just have to play through it. Oh, how much is Huffer?
11.
Oh
my goodness, he gets it.
He can put his opponent at 1.
Oh, this reaction from Powder. Oh, like, are you kidding me?
Always Huffer.
Always Huffer. But how much
he
damage
needs healbot instantly. 1 out of 12.
Wow, that Huffer. Esports?
That's not healbot.
There's no way, no.
Well, you can Azure Drake into healbot.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, Azure Drake is his last hope.
1 out of 12 and 1 out of 11.
Oh! This is the reaction from Life Coach there too. Like, not happy to see the top deck heal, but for obvious reasons.
That was a huge draw for Powder.
Yeah, it really was. It was the only card in
his deck. Powder knows it too. You can see it in his face.
And I think Powder won now. He has Soulfire and Abusive Surgeon.
Yeah, so that's 6 plus 8 exactly damage from hand and right? 11 on board. That's exactly lethal. As long as he doesn't forget about his spell powers. Okay, well, that makes it even more obvious, yeah.
Wow.
Esports?
Pretty much.
But to be fair, Life Coach got lucky first by rolling the Huffer. So, if that Animal Companion was something else than a Huffer, Powder was still winning.
At the same time, as you said, like Life Coach could have played around with the healbot getting back into the hand by just trading
that's
more effectively.
That's also true. I think that might have cost him the game. That decision, because it gave Powder so much more time.
Yeah,
it seems like a rare mistake from Coach, but he thought that the healbot couldn't be returned to hand somehow.
Well, one thing you might want to consider is that Life Coach these days, he's pretty much only been playing Patron Warrior, Handlock, and Druid in Conquest formats. So it seems like maybe, is there a chance that he's not as familiar with Hunter as he was back in the day?
Yeah. Of course, he's not like as back in the day, but he still can play the deck really well, because even if you play like only Patreon, you still get to see how other decks are doing versus Patreon, and you can learn other decks by just playing Patreon. It sounds weird, but when you play against some decks, you can learn them.
Yeah, I know. Like, I've learned a lot of that stuff too, like Patrons. By playing Handlock, I know what beats me when I'm playing Handlock, so I know how to play Patrons against Handlock, even though I don't play Patrons. It's pretty funny. Just do the things that I lose to.
That's a good philosophy there. And now, even though Powder, like Artie, you said his strategy isn't working out in the sense that he can't beat a Handlock 3-0, but it seems like he's still beating all of other Life Coach's decks.
Yeah, even if you have like 40% every matchup, you can still win the series.
Yeah, it's possible. And now it's at 2-0. Life Coach is looking pretty serious.
Some small mistakes from Life Coach last game. I think he would have won it if he did the Savish play and killed the healbot. Because you might can beat double heal, but we cannot beat 3 heal bots.
No.
Yeah, it's very true.
So now he just needs to free out the paladin, right?
Yep.
Yeah. I'm actually really curious as to what type of paladin Life Coach is bringing. In the past, Life Coach is pretty well known for being...
To Trio the Druid, sorry.
Trio the Druid, yeah. Powder is playing the Druid. I'm used to seeing the Paladin from Powder instead of Life Coach. Yeah.
Powder doesn't keep the Harrison. Usually keep the Harrison versus midrange or control, and you don't keep it versus aggro, so he expects aggro Paladin from Life Coach.
Yeah.
His hand is really good versus aggro Paladin.
Oh yeah.
Still waiting to see the Paladin hand. What's it? What is it?
Okay.
Wow.
So that's something more in the lines of what I expected.
Yeah, that's like Life Coach.
Yeah.
Life Coach type of Paladin for sure.
Life Coach is well known for playing pretty much only control Paladin and not midrange Paladin. I think he got the list from you, Savitz, who somewhat got it from Hot Form.
Yeah, Hot Form is where I got it from, like double lay on hands, that type of thing. Yeah. A really, really greedy late game deck. It's a deck that doesn't do so well in ladder right now, but it's still quite viable for tournaments if you get the right matchups.
Would you ever consider innervating the Keeper here?
It's a bit off curve, but it might be the play.
Cause playing Shade is bad versus Master.
Yeah, it's so bad. I don't think you can play the Shade. What are the other options?
Like it's 50-50. Just play the Shade to survive.
Through the Claw, I guess.
I think the Keeper is the play, even though you float at one mana.
You actually float two because you play Shade next turn, unless you double the 6 to innervate it.
Yeah, it's pretty bad with the mana, but what else do you do?
But it is the right play.
Yeah, I think so.
You can also like just play the Shade, and if he wins a 50-50, you just swipe the board.
Well, what about the Marisu?
Shade and Keeper. What about Shade and Keeper? Both.
Oh, like two inner rates. I didn't even consider that.
She has two inner rates. That might be even better.
Yeah, it doesn't sound bad at all, actually.
Why not use it?
Then he needs to top deck something for turn 4. He'll have a blank turn.
That's true. But still, getting the Shade out early is pretty tempting against the Paladin. It's unlikely that there will be a Consecration because he would have to use the coin for it. And after that, the only way to deal with it is either Sylvanas or an Equality Consecration.
He considers attacking the Keeper. It's probably not worth it, right?
Well, he's probably thinking about how he's going to kill this, or how the interactions will go with the Keeper against the Silverhand Recruits.
Mm-hmm.
Most likely, the Keeper will attack into one, possibly two of them over the next two turns. But then that's still not enough with the weapon hits to kill the Keeper off automatically. So if he wanted to commit to hitting the Keeper, he would have to hit it twice at least.
The Powder knows that the Life Coach still has the coin, so he has to go for that swipe. Coin quarter must have been quite devastating. Even if there's only two of those 1/1s up, it would still be a huge tempo gain for the Paladin.
Life Coach's hand is pretty dead. That's like one of the issues why this deck is not that consistent usually.
He really wanted to go for the Coin Quartermaster on this turn, but now obviously it wouldn't be very good.
For justice.
Oh man, what do you even play here? It's just a
Coin Killbot.
Yeah.
That looks like the only play.
It's pretty bad, but out of these options, I guess it's the best one.
Oh, now...
I think innervate Druid of the Claw, or... I mean, innervate Ancient of Lore, or just go for the Druid of the Claw.
Yeah, if this skill bot were on the board, I think Ancient of Lore would probably be the definite pick.
Oh, yeah, because now the heal bot would take it out so easily. Yeah.
Hmm.
The Keeper.
Yeah. Alor is pretty nice here.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think you can afford to play the Master for Battle into that board, even if you know that your opponent has already used the swipe. You want to keep it for maybe turn 8?
I think so too, yeah.
It's really greedy.
Just
though.
Do it on the same turn as the Quartermaster.
Yeah.
But yeah, Aldor is nice here.
You can even, just Aldor, Silence, and then Aldor.
Yeah, that's okay.
Do you really want to silence the Druid of the Claw?
It's a close call, because like the other option is to Hero Power. And by silencing that, he could kill off the Keeper of the Crow with the Healbot.
Yeah. I think one thing to consider is, does Life Coach put Powder on playing Ancients of War? Because if there are no Ancients of War, there actually aren't that many silence targets in the Druid deck. There's Pilot Shredders, of course, but there's more recently, players have been cutting Sylvanas from their Druid decks.
I don't think he put him on the War, because Powder never plays with War.
I haven't seen Powder play Wars.
plays with like tigers and stuff.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
Can't blame him for this.
I like the attack because you set up the consecration.
Yeah, the owl would have felt almost wasted there if he went for it.
That's actually a really good point, Radu. Powder is actually known in the pro community for playing Stranglehorn Tigers in his druid deck. I saw him laddering yesterday, and he had a tiger on the board, a shade on the board, and the patient assassin on the board. And I was like, are you just playing like stealth druid?
Stealth druid? Yeah. Wow, new meta. I gotta try that after the tournament.
Stranglehorn Tiger is pretty bad, but it's really good with the combo.
Yeah. So many good 5-drops for druid. Seems like every single 5-drop in the game fits for druid. Maybe not the Spiteful Smith.
Not a heal bot.
Yeah, not a heal bot either, no. I mean, against Hunter it would be okay, but in general, no.
Don't you beat Hunter anyways most of the time with druid?
Depends. If you're really greedy with double Azure tricks, then probably no. If you have at least one Belcher, I guess you're fine.
Consecration, trade,
yeah,
and then see
like
what
it.
He gets. Then yeah. You go like for boom, and then monster, quartermaster.
I mean,
on the other hand, you expect yeah. Ancient of Lore from Powder.
He could also Owl here and then Consecrate, use the weapon for the clean board to make sure that there's no 3-2 coming out, which would trade for the Alder. Because next turn, he has the next turns like all planned out, so I don't think he needs the Owl right now. Turn 7, Dr. Boom. Turn 8, Master of Appel, Quartermaster. So the Owl won't get played in 2 turns anyway. So I think he can just do it here.
Yeah, and not only that, but if you play the Owl here, then you expect your opponent to have the Ancient of Lore. So your 3-3 and your 2-1 deals with that Ancient of Lore completely. And then on the very next turn, you'll have Dr. Boom against an empty board.
Okay, so this play is also quite good. He's setting up the Quartermaster. He knows that he can also hero power before playing the Quartermaster, so there's high chance that he's gonna...
And if he gets swipe, he plays Boom.
Yeah. And there's no swipe.
That's a really interesting line.
Yeah, it is. I wasn't thinking about this at first, but the more I look at it, the more I like it. I actually like it a lot.
Being Powder, you can rough first and try to get the swipe, and then innervate the lore if you don't get it. Because if you play lore and you get the swipe, you cannot play it. And you really want to swipe because you know for sure that he has Quartermaster.
Yeah. Wow. There's going to be so many of those 1-1s. At least 2 of them are going to survive.
There's the tigers.
Do you innervate hero power or rough? If you innervate, you probably innervate hero power, right?
I think so, yeah. You want to save the wrath?
Yeah, you need the wrath to take care of the other 3-3s that you probably know will spawn.
That Quartermaster value is still going to be very good.
He considers not innervating because he has a really good power play next turn. He still has Life Tiger into Shade, into possible combo. Like, Life would really expect combo on turn 9.
Yeah.
I like the way Powder played it. He goes for the aggressive route. Trying to make Lifewash think that he has combo. Uh-huh.
Going the aggressive route definitely makes a lot of sense with Powder's specific druid deck that has the tigers.
Yes.
Is the Quartermaster really that good here? Because,
Having combo is like having Quartermaster. Your opponent is forced to play around it, usually, if you don't have it.
How do you trade here?
You probably just go for face. And then consecrate next turn, I don't know. Or you try to trade and then lay on hands next turn. But you usually want to keep the cons, right? And cons next turn, because the lore is going to turn into a 3-3. And even if he trades into your 2-5, you can still attack with the face and trade. There's also the chance that he plays a Shade of Naxxramas turn 8 to set up for the turn 9 combo, so consecration gets more value. So I guess you just ignore the board and go for face, right?
But it's just that the druid is at 29 right now. Let's say the druid was at 20, then I think it would be an easy call to just go for face. But here it's just... You're still so far off even if you get that 10 damage in this turn.
I think you still go for face to force him to trade. I really don't like trading.
It's like he's gonna do at least a little bit of it.
And now we might just see the double stealth being played this turn.
The Shade gets consecrated. Oh, he does a force of nature. Oh, Powder is gonna trade. I think that if you go for double stealth, you go for phase two. Oh, that's really sticky.
It is. Maybe you go just for the
still
tiger
the consecration.
And brought. Yeah. Powder must be thinking about the consecration here. He hasn't seen a single one yet, and he knows that in that type of paladin there is 2 for sure.
So you say that Rough is better than Shade?
I'm not sure. It might be.
If you play Shade and you get consecrated, your Tiger, let's say if you have combo, is 21. So still not enough.
Yeah.
So Ruff might be the better play for Powder.
I think. Well, we know the cards. I'm just trying to evaluate that if I didn't know the cards, would I still go with the Rod? This is the right call. That consecration would have been too good.
Oh, there's the Pilot Sky Golem. That's like kind of the defining card of Control Paladin.
Yeah.
Powder has 24 with combo, if he has combo. With four cards in hand, do you put him on combo? What do you think of this? You play Druid a lot.
Both of the Innervates are gone, and he knows that it still wouldn't be lethal, so I would probably just go for the boom.
Well,
something like Sky Golem and playing the Iron Beak Owl, taking out the Spider, seems fine too.
If you see your opponent does play the Stranglehold Tigers, though, you kind of put him on two sets of combos in his deck, definitely.
Yeah.
So there's a pretty high chance of him having that combo.
Yeah. But I mean, the combo is not enough.
Yeah, combo is 24.
It would be one off, so that's like the big thing. So even if he has it, I mean, you think that it's more likely for your opponent to have it than not have it, but you're just like, you're kind of okay with it. Oh,
that's exactly what he needed to play the Shade.
It's a good card.
He can still consecrate for 9. It's not that bad. Like, Boombox consecrate and then get a bit lucky with the hits.
Yeah, it works.
You know that there's no way your opponent has lethal as Powder, so you just play it and go for face probably. Do you unstealth the Tiger?
Yeah, I think so. Because there's a low tap also on board, so you have 2 5/5s that need to be dealt with. And he doesn't have the Roar in his hand yet. I would absolutely go for face with it. Because of the low tap. There's another thing. So the Dr. Boom won't be able to trade for both of those.
Powder is calculating what survives and the damage.
Yeah.
You can shoot Life Coach at 19.
What about killing one of the Boombots with the Spider?
I don't think it's needed. Because they will kill your...
Besides
trading.
He's going for Power Control table. Well, that's gonna be a good consecration. even for 9 mana, it's quite amazing. So with the Zombie Chow, you first go into the Creeper.
Yeah, you trade Zombie Chow, you consecrate, then you trade a 1/1, see how it hits, hope it hits low tap. If not, you just trade the boom, right?
Yeah.
It's not incredibly terrible. Because if you control the game, you'll win the late game with this kind of deck.
Yeah. I'm gonna be looking at Powder's reaction when the consecration comes down.
This deck is really gritty, but it seems to work out.
I think this is the turning point in the game when he consecrates here. Up to this point, it has been kind of even, but this consecration gets so much value. It's 5 minions.
This is a really important 50-50.
Yeah, it is. He really wants to hit the load. Oh,
he's still attack,
gonna
right?
try. Yeah, he's gonna try for sure.
Oh. Well, never lucky.
At least he can go face with the Dr. Boom, but taking that extra 5, it really hurts. Double force. Oh.
Is your best out going Force of Nature face and hoping he doesn't have heal or taunt?
So. Yeah, you can it's enough if you go face with just 2 of the tree ants and send 1 into the Zombie Chow, because you can also hero power. So with 2 tree ants and the hero power, it would still okay.
Well, Shredder is more sticky.
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah.
It's really hard for Life Coach to deal with Shredder and to deal with the 3-2 that comes out.
The problem with sending a tree into the Zombie Chow is it gives your opponent Truce Over Champion as also an out.
You mean by leaving it off?
By leaving the Zombie Chow out.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Like, you didn't see a 2 silver yet, so.
Yeah. Good video.
Oh. Is that even good? Probably still lay on hands, right?
I think you lay on hands, yeah.
And then you can...
Maybe potentially Iron Beak Owl.
Yeah.
The Owl is not going to get any better. You can go for the board control game here, I think.
A really greedy play would be like Iron Beak Owl, the Shredder, trade the Boom into the Shredder, and then heal the Boom.
Wow. But would he die the combo then? No, it would be one off. But I think that's too creative.
It would be one damage of lethal.
Yeah, that's too creative.
But yeah, you don't do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's just lay on hands and then maybe play the Owl on Shredder.
Yeah, if you lay on hands, you get back to like pretty high HP. And the only thing you're really afraid of here is combo. There's no way for Powder to come back without just killing it.
I wouldn't like absolutely hate if you just played a Juggler and Shredder. I mean, Juggler and Owl and Pilot of Sky Golem. But he has to take care of the Shredder. I'm sure he has to worry about the combo at this point. It's so likely that the combo exists right now.
Does it threaten lethal this way?
Probably not, because because the keeper of the crow can trade for that that knife juggler. So there's it would not be enough.
I do feel though that it's threatening enough that you have to use your force of nature to clear. At least somewhat.
That's pretty interesting. I think he's gonna leave up the sky golem. Yeah.
Don't you also want to put your opponent in like combo range?
Then he would have to leave something more up, maybe the juggler.
He would have to leave Dr. Boom up almost.
Whoa, that is pretty quick. I don't know if I like. Well,
he can
kill them off. I guess it's good. Because we also trade. Yeah, there's no way he can
die. And this is like the ideal scenario, even.
Yeah.
For control paladin.
That works out pretty well.
Life Coach makes this deck work.
Just swipe face.
Yeah, swipe face
is the
play.
Top deck the thing. But he has two roars in the deck, most likely still. I mean, there has to be two roars. There's two force of nature. Sometimes when we see the player counter combo piece, it's the force of nature.
You died through silver now.
Yeah, a lot of things. There's 13 on board. Well, not that many. Oh, what there it is. Consecration would have been one of. So he needed precisely the first one, and he got it.
Yeah, if he didn't get it though, he was like, it's almost 100% chance to win this game with double
heal
on your hand.
That's true. He would have still won it, so not that big of a deal. It just made things a bit quicker.
So now what does Life Coach have versus Powder's Druid?
He has his own Druid, and he still has the Hunter remaining, I believe.
Hunter is really favored versus Druid, but the Druid mirror match can go either way, depending on multiple factors that Savish can tell us.
Yeah, Wildcrowth, Inner Maid.
Shades?
Emperor?
Isn't like the best thing for me, or like coin shade into shade, or innervate shade
that's
into coin
good,
shade?
That's pretty good, yeah. Those are almost impossible to deal with. Innervate shade, coin shade.
Oh, it's actually, Life Coach banned the Druid, so it's going to be probably some type of
Oh, that's true,
for
we forgot about it.
No, like powder banned Druid. Exactly.
Powder banned Druid, yeah.
But how is Patron versus Druid? I played Patron a lot, and I'm not sure if Druid is that good of a matchup. Like, double innervate makes it good, but I would say it's like 50-50 or a little bit favored for Patron.
Yeah, I would probably say it's around there. It depends who you ask, obviously. Mm-hmm. Just stats-wise, the mid-range Druid is favored by exactly 55% to 45%. But you typically find that Patron players tend to misplay more than the Druid counterparts.
Yeah. Like, we can assume that Life Coach and Powder are not going to misplay there. So, like, we'll see some good quality games, I think. Life Coach goes for the good matchup first. Yeah. But Powder can still get some good draws and be the Hunter.
Yeah, basically some inner rates and wild growths, but at least he's missing the wild growth. Life Coach must be feeling good about that.
A pretty bad hand for Powder.
It is, it's too slow. He needs the inner rate. Inner rate would be the best card in his deck right now.
Yeah. Not only that, but you kind of feel like Powder's deck is probably not the best against aggro. Instead of like Ancients of War or even like Sludge Belchers, he has those Tigers.
Yeah, Belcher is the card that you wish you had against the Hunter. Keeper on the knife juggler, not too bad.
Would you ever freezing trap here?
I would. I mean, it's gonna be 6 mana to play again, so it's like the same as killing it.
Yeah.
Plus, it can
you don't want to quick shot that.
Yeah, it can test too well against the minions you have on your board already.
Yeah.
6 mana keeper is only good if you plan on silencing Savannah and you have already the board. But it's hard to get the board versus hunters, right?
Yeah. Quite often on turns like these, the freezing trap serves as a removal because the mana cost going up on the minion makes them unplayable. Like the best way for the druid has to deal with the freezing trap would be the force of nature, and because then only one treant would be frozen, which is easy to play again and get some use out of. But it's only turn 4 right now, so the force of nature is quite far off.
Loteb is really good now.
Yeah,
and the
is.
Hunter's mark is huge.
It's not the time for it just yet though.
Because you expect Druid of the Claw next turn, and you can just trade the lever now.
And with the quick shot in hand, that Hunter's mark is even better because it's so easy to get it out of your hand and get the extra card draw fast. It's looking really good for Life Coach. Powder already down to 18 and there's 7 power on the board. Oh, wow. And there's the bow.
That's a lot.
That's so much damage right now.
We don't know the secret yet.
Can deal 12 to Powder. has the hunter's mark, has the death rattle from that leper now. This looking hopeless for Powder right now. Which trap was it? Was it explosives?
What does Powder need right now?
Don't? I don't even know. There's like probably nothing. Well, that's certainly not it.
Well, he needs.
Oh, he needs Vitality Totem. That's what he needs.
Okay.
Vitality Totem.
Yes, it's his only chance.
What's the chance of that?
One in. Was
60 something.
68 or. I'm not sure. I can't remember the exact number.
Does Powder run a Acidic Swamp Ooze and Harrison in his Druid? If yes, he's really favored versus Patron.
I'm not sure. We haven't seen the Ooze.
He knows he needs that or a con. Oh,
that's not vitality.
No, I can see.
And that was a really quick game.
It sure was. Yeah.
Powder started the series off 2-0, but in two successive quick games, Life Coach has brought it back, and it's right now down to Druid versus Patron. A pretty even matchup, I'd say.
Yeah, usually when we see games this fast, it's because there's a Huffer, and the Huffer ends up dealing like 12 damage. But that was just Powder hero powering in turn two, but. Happens sometimes.
That's what Druid does. They don't. Yeah. If they don't get it early game, they're really struggling.
Yeah, and also not having the Belcher there. I don't know. It might have been a stronger play there than the Lotef was. It would have slowed down the Hunter a little bit. Probably would still not have won the game. But yeah.
We already saw the Harrison in Powder's hand.
Yep, keeping it in the starting hand, absolutely the right decision against Warrior.
And the Wild Growth, which is going to be like really huge.
Yeah, and the Harrison Jones. This seems like the ideal hand.
Okay,
this is the thing with Druid. Like, you don't get it two games, but the third game you'll probably get it. Like, mathematically,
unless you're Savitz playing the Archon League, of course.
I played 5 matches in a row without drawing Wild Growth. It feels bad, man. But just look at this hand. It's completely... different from the previous one.
Yeah, Druid is really favored with this kind of hands.
He could even play a turn 3 Dr. Boom with that. He was probably not going to because of Exeggut, but still. This radar is already...
Also probably not going to because of a possibility of...
Acolyte is really nice here.
Yeah, it is. But except like the only problem with that is that he could get silenced on curve. So sometimes you want to play it when the Druid is about to hit 5 mana, so even if they keeper it, then it's still going to at least a little bit like be awkward for them. Because on turn 5, you want to play a 5-drop, not a 4-drop.
There might be some reasons to play Frothing. Frothing looks bad versus Shredder, encourages Powder to play Shredder, and then you just kill the Shredder with the weapon.
The good thing for the Acolyte is that even if there is a Keeper, he can use the Fiery War Axe and the Acolyte to take out the Keeper and then Battle Rage for 2 cards. So that's kind of okay.
Being Powder, you should never Harrison a Fiery War Axe, right?
Oh,
you always go for
not,
the Death Bite.
I mean, he could have done it last turn with the Innervate and the Coin if he wanted to, but I guess he's keeping it for the Death Bite.
It might have been a really good power play on turn 2 to do that.
It's actually pretty interesting, because he would have drawn 2 cards instantly. Maybe he should have done it.
But yeah, if he went for that, like how would you lose if you go for that?
I don't know.
Yeah,
still, well, now it's coming out for sure, right? I mean, how do you...
Now just
two
boom,
cards,
right?
That's such a huge deal. I would be so tempted to draw the cards here. Okay.
I like the boom.
It's gonna get the Executor for sure, but I can understand that.
I think this is one of those situations where, like, you always have in your mind that, okay, I have to Harrison a Death Spite against Patron Warrior, but it never comes in the situation where you have the opportunity to turn to Harrison, a Fiery War Axe.
I mean, I would never, ever...
I think you do the Harrison. It's like so good because he played on turn 2, so he doesn't have a good follow-up for that, right?
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't Harrison a one-charge Fiery War Axe. It's so important to get out the Death Spite, but I would love to see it here. I'm going to be honest. Like on that turn, drawing those 2 extra cards just by using a coin and getting at 5-4, it would have been pretty sweet.
I think that the Innervate top deck changed things because you don't usually calculate a top deck and you have to like think on spot. He probably had already the whole game planned out with his Wild Growth, like all the turns.
Yeah, and not only that, it just feels like that's like a 1 in 1,000 scenario that you never get practice against.
Like this is, I would call it Dr. Fail in this situation. Like it didn't get all that much done. Like all it was that it traded for an Exeggut. Those Boombots might also whip, like they might only deal 1 damage. So that was coin and an Innervate and the Dr. Boom all for that. But it seems like, okay, yeah. So now the Harrison value is not there anymore. maybe a missed opportunity from Powder.
Do you charge the Druid of the Claw to be safe? But it's really bad versus Swirlwind.
Yeah, it is, but I think you still do it. There's no coin in Life Coach's hand. Because then you know that there won't be like Patron Whirlwind coming. And Whirlwind is such a valuable card that if it gets used here without the Patrons, at least it's going to be out of the way.
I think Powder is still in the lead.
Yeah, he is. I would say so as well.
Unstable Ghoul Acolyte?
Yeah, that seems really good. I like that a lot.
Would you ever kill a bomb to like bounce it into the Unstable Ghoul or into the Acolyte to get even more draw, but or is not worth it?
I don't know. Like, he doesn't have another weapon in his hand, so I would be tempted to try save the last weapon charge. But I wouldn't hate that play. But it just might hit face and then you wasted your weapon.
The most likely scenario anyway, if you play the ghoul and the pain here, is the bombs will go off and there might still be a chance that the bombs hit the acolyte anyway.
That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Probably the best possible turn.
So you first trade and then see how the bombs hit and then maybe low tip.
Maybe you just wrath the Acolyte. You really want to
do. Oh yeah, you can wrath the Acolyte. And then play the Shredder.
This way he can also guarantee that the bombs are going to hit face, so he gets some extra damage there. The unfortunate thing is that the Fiery War Axe is going to be the perfect tool to deal with the first half of the Shredder. Four and...
Oh
my goodness!
Yeah, the Boombot RNG damage from is those just bombs. Completely reversed from Life Coach's Boombot RNG.
Yeah.
I think those two Boombots did more damage than all four of Life Coach's Boombots.
It's like a Pyroblast almost. Yeah. There. Like, two
pyro
damage
Pyroboom.
Pyro That's boom. The power of Innervating Boom, but I'm still not sure if it's a better power play than Innervating Harrison on turn two. It's like something we should analyze after.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Nomish trade and then.
Yeah. Oh, that's exactly the card he wanted. Because now for next turn, he's going to have access to spawning.
It's
the
a really
patrons.
Slow hand. You shouldn't be able to afford it. Like, you expect lore from your opponent, and you cannot go for the patron combo into lore, right?
You can't?
You're going too low because of that two Boombas that hit perfectly.
Okay.
You might consider even slamming that. It's a hard decision.
If you slam it, you'll almost go all in here.
I mean, then he's clearly going for the patrons if he slams that. If he doesn't slam, then I would. He might not do it. But.
Maybe Hero Pouring is better.
It might be, because that Gnomish Inventor already is gonna kill that on the board. It's a close call, though. I don't hate this.
So now Powder needs to low tap, and that stops the Patron combo.
Yeah, it's a pretty good low tap here.
He doesn't have combo pieces yet, but he has the Harrison. BGH is not that good. This game is really hard to say how it will go.
Yeah, it is. Like, Powder pushed for so much damage early on. But there's that combo, and now he's gonna... Or he can even make like a battle rage. Oh, he can actually do all of that.
Yeah.
He can play his entire hand next turn. And if there's minions up, that's gonna be... The battle rage is gonna be drawing five cards or something.
How close is Powder from lethal? If he charges the Druid of the Claw and Hero Powers face, or plays BGH.
It's pretty close, yeah.
So anything like a swipe top deck would do it?
Just do it?
Yeah, and now the problem is if Life Coach just goes for the play with a lot of patrons, he can't clear off the board, so he actually can't do that play.
But Harrison Jones is looking so sad in Powder's
hand. I think
right
you start
now.
With like Whirlwind Battle Rage and then see where this goes.
Yeah, I mean, he would be dead otherwise. If he plays the entire combo, there's going to be too much stuff on the board, right?
Yeah. Life Coach needs a really good set of draws, maybe Shield Block too. Shield Block is a really good card in this kind of situations, helps you stabilize, and that's what you need versus the Druid that is top decking.
Yeah.
I think Life Coach typically doesn't play Shield Block in his patron decks, right? I haven't seen him recently.
No, he does. On stream, he only plays with Shield Block.
Okay. It's like a more recent addition that almost everyone has been running in, right?
I don't know. Shield Block is really popular on the ladder. A lot of people play it.
It's So if he was to go for the Grim Patrons, you know, like Inner Rage, Whirlwind, Battle Rage, he would lose the game. He knows that there's two combos. There's, well, even Keeper of the Crow would do it. Oh no. Oh no no. There's like 8 cards now that kill him. I don't know if I like this play. So many cards that kill him now. And we know that there's a swipe.
You cannot even click the board if you do this.
Yeah,
play.
Yeah. Oh no.
I think now there's
aren't you dead on board?
Yeah, yeah. I think
yeah.
There's no way you can win.
He's you
didn't execute maybe?
No.
Why didn't he whirlwind before?
I'm pretty shocked by this. I would have expected him to just go for the whirlwind. Draw 4 cards, one from the Acolyte and one.
You're dead on board.
Oh no.
I don't know.
Yeah. Life got shaking his head. Not happy about that then.
Even takes his head to
yeah. He knows it's over.
Devastating series for Life Coach there.
But so Powder wins.
Yeah, Powder takes that series. Pretty interesting games, even though Powder, it seemed like his strategy was to counter a handlock. Life Coach didn't bring the handlock, but it still seemed to work out in the end.
What happened on that last turn? I think he had an okay chance still to try draw. With the Whirlwind and Battle Rage, that's 3 mana. He gets 4 draws. He gets 1 draw from the Acolyte, 3 from the Battle Rage. He could have still traded the Acolyte into the BGH, drawing a total of 5 cards. I think that would have given him a fair chance to make something happen with the remaining 5 mana. Maybe shield block, maybe execute the 5-5. I don't know. I feel like Life Coach maybe dropped the ball a little bit there.
It's just a rare Life Coach brain fart at the last moment. But you know what? Our man of the hour here is Powder. How are you feeling today, Powder?
I'm feeling good. I mean, when I saw his lineup, I was a little bit sad.
Yeah, you were targeting Warlock, right?
Yeah. Well, Warlock and kind of Patron as well. I was actually thinking about my lineup a lot this morning, mm-hmm. and I kind of went with this in the last second. And then when I was in the shower after I submit, I was like, as long as he doesn't take out Handlock and bring Paladin,
really,
I'm okay. And then he takes out Handlock and brings Paladin.
Wow.
Well. So, but I got lucky. But that's Hearthstone, so.
Yeah, it seemed to work out for you in the end. How much of your preparation came down to specifically countering Life Coach, and how much of it came down to winning the tournament, facing off against the top 4 and the top 2?
I mean, first of all, it was kind of going against Life Coach. I think it's a little bit hard. I think I got one of the hardest matchups just because Life Coach plays so differently from the rest of the field, and he doesn't tend to bring the same decks. Everyone else is playing pretty aggressive while he's bringing more control decks, so it's kind of hard to counter both at the same time. So I kind of went with this and just like, you have to hope a little bit, so.
Yeah, yeah. Just looking at the lineups, it looks so so bad for you, to be honest. We were also going through it, even right when we saw the control warrior, we were thinking that, okay, you must have been targeting the handlock and it's not there. So it looked pretty bad, but you managed to pull it off, and there's a chance that your next opponent is bringing a handlock. It's actually, we were talking about it, that it's more likely than not that there will be a handlock. It's been one of the most popular decks, so maybe it'll work out.
Hopefully.
Yeah. I have a question about the last game. There was like one really interesting turn where you could have potentially Harrison Jones on turn 2, a 2-charge Fiery War Axe. Like at first, the whole panel thought, no, you don't do that. You save it for Deathspite. But after talking about it a lot, we were like, hey, maybe that Harrison Jones is correct. Did you have any misgamings playing Dr. Boom instead on the next turn?
No, turn 4 was maybe like, on turn 2 it was Wild Growth.
Yeah.
But on turn 4, when you had the coin inner way, but think about it, if the Boom gets executed, just playing the Harrison, would match up so well against the basement, but you would have had a 5-4 against the 2-4. You draw 2 extra cards.
But he played the
Frothing Berserker.
The Frothing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I kind of felt like anyway, I played it. I wasn't really thinking about the Harrison, to be honest. I was kind of like tunnel vision on the Deathbite.
Yeah.
Because I knew I was like, with my hand, I could do so much damage. Like, I mean, even if I throw out Dr. Boom, there's no way he plays a minion and kills it. Mm-hmm. So I knew I would get a threat on board next turn. It kind of worked out so that he had like the one thing I didn't want him to have, which was the slam execute. If he whirlwind executed, I thought it was fine. Like, the chance of my Boombots killing his Frothing was pretty high.
Yeah, and I think you and even had a Big Game Hunter, which would have been
available, which would have been fine too. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't know. I was, like, sitting there just like, hero power, hero power, hero power on turn three so I could play my Dr. Boom, and then the game would have been over, basically. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't know. Playing Dr. Boom on turn three, I don't think that's ever incorrect.
It feels pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah. Final question, I guess, is you're running a very atypical Druid with Stranglehorn Tigers. I've seen you play a lot with it on ladder, and I've seen you actually have something like a Stranglehorn Tiger Shade and Patient Assassin board in your games on ladder before. Can you explain why you choose that particular card?
Because every aggro deck right now is running two Owls, if you want to run like a more aggressive Druid without like Ancient of Wars and stuff, your Belcher is going to get silenced so often. So if you play a Tiger instead, there's no way they can kill it because it's stealth. And it just gives you one more way to win. So if they're like at 20, 21 HP, you just play your Tiger and then you can combo them next turn. So you can kind of race with that card. And the same goes with Shade. You can like Shade and Tiger together is a lot of damage as well. So I'm playing a very, very aggressive Druid. So, yeah.
Interesting way to think about it. We had theorized that it's more of an anti-control card, but it does have its anti-aggro applications as well.
Yeah, I actually think it's more anti-aggro than anti-control because like against control, a 5-5 isn't that good. I mean, it doesn't trade that well. Like, I mean, Belcher is still a little bit better. I don't know. I just find it that it's a very aggressive card, and I like being aggressive.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to be keeping an eye on the Tiger, how well it performs. I think it's an interesting addition, and can work quite well. Yeah. But is it better than a Belcher, or is it better than a Drake? Tough to tell.
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard, for sure.
Well, congrats, Powder, and good luck in the next round. Before we take our break, let's take a look at the brackets. Let's see how Powder will be matching up. Of course, Powder did defeat Life Coach, and our next match will be Hoy versus Martin Creek.
Yes, the winner of those two will be playing against Powder in the semifinals later today. What do we know of Martin Creek?
Martin Creek is the only qualified player that's coming into this tournament, and he's also, I believe, on SK Gaming and a Swedish player as well.
Cool. Looking forward to seeing him play. Hoish, of course, has been really, really strong overall in this tournament. Your pick to win the entire tournament,
yeah, exactly. Potentially. And now with Life Coach, I think he was your pick to win out. Mm-hmm. I think I have pretty good chances.
Yeah. Hoish has been really impressive with his plays and his lineup also, a really solid player. Like you brought up yesterday that he likes to play a lot of the same stuff. It's going to be interesting to see if he brings the same stuff today, if his opponent has picked up on the fact that he likes to play the same things. Maybe he has countered. Mm-hmm. I'm really looking forward to the next match.
Oh yeah, certainly. And we're going to take a short break now, but right after, we're going to have Hoy versus Martin Creek. See you then.